Myself, Dr. Sarika Kate, Associate Professor from Department of Anatomy, RMC, PIMS, Pune, presenting lecture on the facial nerve. Facial nerve can be asked as a long question for the university examination. So let's see the detailed course of it. Objectives of today's lecture are, you have to see the functional components and the nuclei of the facial nerve, detailed course of the facial nerve, branches and the distribution, and the clinical importance of the facial nerve. Facial nerve, it is a seventh cranial nerve. It is a mixed type of nerve. It is having two roots, motor root and a sensory root. The motor root is somewhat larger as compared to the sensory root. The motor root is lying onto the medial aspect, while the sensory root is lying in between that of the motor root and the vestibulocochlear nerve, which is lying onto the lateral aspect. Now this comes out from the junction of the lower border of the pons and the upper border of the medulla, in between the inferior cerebellar peduncle and the olive. Moving on to the functional components of the nerve. It is having the spatial visceral efferent component represented by the motor nucleus. Now this nucleus, it is located in the lower pons and it supplies the muscles which are developed from the second arch medullary. Next component is the general visceral efferent component. This is represented by the superior salivatory nucleus, which is lying rostral to that of the pontomedullary junction. The preganglionic secretomotor fibers to lacrimal salivary glands, the mucous glands of the pharynx, palate and the nose, these are supplied by the superior salivatory nucleus. Spatial visceral afferent column. It is represented by the nucleus of the tractus solitarius, which is present in the medulla, and it conveys the taste fibers from the anterior two-third part of the tongue and the soft palate. The general somatic afferent component, represented by the spinal nucleus and the tract of trigeminal nerve, present in the medulla, and it carries the cutaneous sensations from the external acoustic meatus. Moving on to the central connections of the facial nerve. Now whatever that nuclei, they receives the corticonuclear and the corticobulbar fibers from the motor cortex. The part of nucleus which supplies the upper part of face, it receives the corticonuclear fibers from both cerebral hemispheres, while the part of motor nucleus which supplies the lower part of face is controlled by the motor cortex of the opposite cerebral hemisphere. Now moving on to the course and the relations of the nerve. The nerve takes a complicated course. It is having the intracranial part, intratemporal part and an extracranial part of it. The intracranial part, this section is taken at the lower part of the pons. The nucleus is lying in the deep reticular formation of the pons. The motor nucleus, it takes an unusual course. It initially passes backwards and medially to reach the lower pole of the adjacent nucleus. then it ascends and passes onto the medial aspect of the adjacent nucleus, and finally it turns upward, forward, and laterally. It turns upwards, forwards, and laterally to make a loop around that abducent nucleus. Now, this arched fibers, these are known as the internal genu of the facial nerve, and this forms a surface elevation in the floor of the fourth ventricle that is known as a facial folliculus. Now, this phenomenon of shift of the nerve cell towards the maximum stimulation is known as neurobiotaxis. Now, the nerve fibers, they passes through that of the pontomedullary junction. Now, as it comes out through the lower border of the pons along with that of the vestibulocochlear nerve, it passes into the internal acoustic meatus. Now, here it lies in the groove of that vestibulocochlear nerve, and in between the two, there lies the sensory root. Now, at the bottom of the internal acoustic meatus, the motor root and the sensory root, they unite together and they form a trunk, and then they enter into the bony facial canal. Now, as it enters into the bony facial canal, it passes laterally above the vestibule to reach the anterosuperior angle of the medial wall of the middle ear. Now, here it takes a sharp bend backwards. This is known as the external genu of the nerve, and here there is an asymmetrical swelling is lying. This is known as genicular ganglion. Now, what is lying in that genicular ganglion? Here lies the cell bodies of the pseudo-unipolar sensory neurons. Now, from that genicular ganglion, the nerve passes in a canal horizontally backwards above the promontory and the fenestra vestibuli, and just below the bulge of the lateral semicircular canal. Now, it again turns downwards at the junction of the medial wall and the posterior wall, where it lies medial to that of the adytus and the cavity of the tympanic antrum. Then the nerve passes downwards at the junction of the medial wall and the posterior wall, and finally it leaves through the stylomastoid foramen . Now here again you can see the course of the facial nerve. Initially it passes laterally, it reaches the anterosuperior angle, it takes a sharp bend that is known as genu. Then it passes horizontally backwards above the promontory and the fenestra vestibuli. Then at the junction of the medial and the posterior wall, it again turns downwards. Now, this turn is medial to that of the adytus to the mastoid antrum. And finally, it turns downwards and leaves the skull through the stylomastoid foramen. Now again here you can see the bony facial canal, entry of the nerve in that horizontally backward course, and then it turns downwards and it leaves the skull through the stylomastoid foramen. Now as it comes out through the stylomastoid foramen, it bends forwards. It turns forwards, lying or with the lateral aspect of the styloid process. And then it turns forwards onto the posteromedial aspect of the parotid gland. Here it lies superficial to that of the retromandibular vein and the external carotid artery. Now in the parotid gland, it is further divided into two trunks, temporofacial trunk and a cervicofacial trunk. The temporofacial trunk is divided into temporal and the zygomatic branches, while the cervicofacial is divided into the buccal, marginal mandibular and the cervical branch. Now moving on to the branches of the facial nerve. From the geniculate ganglion, it gives rise to the greater petrosal nerve. Now the greater petrosal nerve, it comes onto the anterior surface of the petrous part of the temporal through a hiatus for the greater petrosal nerve. It turns forwards and medially in a groove on the anterior surface of the petrous temporal, just beneath that of the trigeminal ganglion, and reaches up till the foramen lacerum. Now here it receives the deep petrosal nerve coming from that of the sympathetic plexus around the internal carotid artery. The greater petrosal and the deep petrosal nerve, they join and they form the nerve of pterygoid canal. It passes through the pterygoid canal and ends into that pterygoparotid ganglion. The postganglionic fibers, they supply the glands of the palate and the nasal mucosa and the postganglionic fibers to the lacrimal gland. Now in the canal, it gives rise to the nerve to the stapedius, opposite to that of the pyramidal eminence. If there is damage to this, it will lead to hyperacusis, where the normal sounds can be appreciated as the loud sounds, as the vibrations, they are not dampened by the stapedius muscle. The next nerve is the caudal tympani nerve. It arises 6 mm above the stylomastoid foramen. It enters into the posterior wall of the tympanic cavity through the posterior canaliculus. Then it passes through the substance of the tympanic membrane, where it crosses the medial side of the handle of the malleus. It leaves the tympanic cavity through the anterior canaliculus, which is situated at the medial end of the petrotympanic fissure. Now, at the medial end of the petrotympanic fissure, the anterior ligament of the malleus and the anterior tympanic branch of the maxillary artery is also present. Now, from that petrotympanic fissure, the caudal tympani nerve, it enters into the intratemporal fossa, deep to that of the lateral pterygoid muscle, where it is related onto the medial side of the spine of the sphenoid. Now, in its lateral relation, there comes the auriculotemporal nerve, the middle meningeal artery, and the inferior alveolar nerve, while anteriorly there lies the nerve of the trunk of the mandibular nerve. Now, the caudal tympani nerve, it joins with that of the lingual nerve at an acute angle, and then it supplies the secretomotor pathway to that of the submandibular gland and the sublingual gland, and also carries the taste sensations from the anterior two-third part of the tongue except the barrett papillae through that lingual nerve. Now, after coming through the stylomastoid canal, it gives a posterior auricular branch which passes backwards. The posterior auricular branch is further divided into occipital branch, which supplies the occipital belly of the occipitofrontalis muscle, and it also gives the auricular branch which supplies the auricularis posterior muscle. It also gives the muscular branches to the posterior belly of digastric and the nerve to the stylohyoid muscle. Now, the terminal branches of the facial nerve in face. The temporofacial trunk is further divided into the temporal and the zygomatic branches. The temporal branches, they supply the auricularis anterior, auricularis superior, frontal belly of the occipitofrontalis muscle, corrugator supercilii. Zygomatic branches, they supply the orbicularis oculi. The cervicofacial trunk is further divided into buccal, the marginal mandibular and cervical branch. The upper buccal branches, they supply the zygomaticus major, zygomaticus minor, levator labii superioris, levator labii superioris a lacunae. The lower buccal branches, they supply the orbicularis oris and the buccinator muscle. The marginal mandibular nerve, it enters into the neck, then it ascends upwards and forwards around the lower border of the mandible and reaches the anteroinferior angle of the masseter, enters onto the face, superficial to that of the facial vein and the facial artery, and supplies the muscles of the lower lip and the chin, risorius, depressor anguli oris, depressor labii inferioris and the mentalis muscle. The cervical branch of the facial nerve, it supplies the platysma. Now, moving on to the branches of the communications of the nerve. The nerve gives a communicating branch to the vestibulocochlear nerve in the internal acoustic meatus. It also communicates with the pterygopalatine ganglion through the greater petrosal nerve. It communicates with the otic ganglion through a branch with lesser petrosal nerve. Now, in the facial canal, it communicates with the auricular branch of the vagus, which probably conveys the cutaneous somatosensory sensations from the auricle. Now, below that stylomastoid foramen, it communicates with the glossopharyngeal, vagus, auriculotemporal nerve and the great auricular nerve. Behind the ear, it communicates with the lesser occipital nerve. Now, in the face, it communicates with that of the trigeminal nerve branches, which probably conveys the proprioceptive sensations from the face. And in the neck, it communicates with the transverse cervical cutaneous nerve. Now, just to trace the different fibers of the facial nerve. The special visceral efferent component, that is the branchiomotor fibers coming from the motor nucleus, it passes through trunk of the nerve, then genicular ganglion, then it supplies the stapedius muscle, then it gives branch to the posterior auricular, then the nerve to the posterior belly of digastric and the styloid muscle, and then the muscles of the facial expression. So this is the branchiomotor component of it, which supplies the different muscles developed from the second branchial arch. Then the preganglionic secretomotor fibers for the lacrimal gland arises from that of the superior salivary nucleus and probably the lacrimatory nucleus. Now it passes through the nervous intermedius, trunk of the facial nerve, genicular ganglion, greater petrosal nerve. Greater petrosal nerve joins with that of the deep petrosal, form the nerve of pterygoid canal, and then it relays into the pterygopalatine ganglion. Now postganglionic fibers from the ganglion, they pass through the maxillary, zygomatic, zygomaticotemporal, a communicative loop between lacrimal and zygomaticotemporal, and ends into the lacrimal gland. Postganglionic fibers from the pterygopalatine ganglion, they passes into the soft palate and the nasal mucosa through the lesser and the greater palatine nerves. The preganglionic secretomotor fibers for the submandibular and the sublingual gland starts from that of the superior salivary nucleus. They passes through the nervous intermedius, trunk of the facial nerve, genicular ganglion. Then it passes through the caudal tympani nerve, the lingual nerve, and relays into the submandibular ganglion. Postganglionic fibers, they pass and they supply submandibular gland directly. Why? The postganglionic fibers, they again joins with that of the lingual nerve, and then they supply to that of the sublingual gland. So this is the general visceral efferent component of the facial nerve. Special visceral afferent component, that is the taste fibers from the anterior two-third part of the tongue carried through the caudal tympani, then the lingual nerve, genicular ganglion, the peripheral processes, they end here. While from the soft palate, the lesser palatine nerves, then the without relaying into the pterygopalatine ganglion, they passes through the nerve of pterygoid canal, then the greater petrosal nerve, and the peripheral processes, they end into the genicular ganglion. The central processes, they pass through that of the trunk of the facial nerve, the nervous intermedius, and they end into the nucleus tractus solitarius. Then the cutaneous somatosensory fibers from that of the auricle, these are passed by that of the auricular branch of the vagus. The peripheral processes, they ends into that genicular ganglion, while the central processes, they pass through the trunk of the facial nerve, the nervous intermedius, and ends into the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. So these are some dressings for the facial nerve. Special visceral efferent component, that is nothing but the branchiomotor component, which supplies the muscles, different muscles, the stapedius, stylohyoid, and the posterior belly of the digastric, and the muscles of the facial expression. The green colored two fibers, one is going towards the lacrimal gland and the soft palate and the nasal mucosa. These are the general visceral efferent component. Again, the second component, again the general visceral efferent going towards that of the submandibular gland, passing through the caudal tympani and the lingual nerve. So these two green colored, these are the general visceral efferent component. Then yellow colored is the special visceral afferent components, which are ending into the, as it is a special visceral, taste fibers from the tongue, anterior two-third part of the tongue and the soft palate. The peripheral processes, they end into genicular ganglion, while the central processes, they relate into the nucleus tractus solitarius. and from the auricle, the cutaneous sensations, they pass through that of the posterior auricular branch of the vagus and a communication between the facial nerve and ends into the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. So these are the tracings of the facial nerve. Moving on to the applied aspect of the facial nerve. The intracranial lesions can be seen in case of the acoustic neuroma and meningioma. Intratemporal part of the nerve is involved most commonly in case of the Bell's palsy, middle ear infections, trauma and neoplasms. The extracranial part of the nerve is involved in case of parotid malignancy as well as while during the surgeries and systemic diseases like diabetes mellitus and leprosy can cause the lesions of the facial nerve. Now when you see the supranuclear palsy, this is the nucleus. This will be the supranuclear fibers, that are the corticonuclear and the corticobulbar fibers coming from the cerebral cortex to the nuclei. If the lesion is at this level, this is known as a supranuclear palsy. And the neurons involved here are the upper motor neurons. The point to note here is the motor nucleus which supplies the upper part of the face. This receives the corticonuclear and the corticobulbar fibers of both sides. While the motor nucleus which supplies the lower part of the face, it receives the corticonuclear and the corticobulbar fibers from the opposite cerebral cortex. So, in case of the UMN lesion, the upper part of the face is escaped, while the lower opposite part of the face is involved. Voluntary movements are more affected than that of the emotional movements in case of the supranuclear palsy. When the lesion is at the nuclear level or the pontine lesion is there, it will lead to the lower motor neuron palsy. Here, loss of movements of the facial muscles on the same side of the lesion, both upper as well as the lower part of the face is involved. In addition to it, as the adjacent nucleus is related at the pontine level, there is internal strabismus is also seen because of the involvement of the lateral rectus muscle. If the pyramidal tract and the corticonuclear and the corticobulbar fibers plus the nuclei are involved, then the condition is known as a Millard-Gubler syndrome. Here, there is contralateral hemiplegia plus ipsilateral facial palsy is seen. Infranuclear palsy. When the lesion is in the course of the nerve, that will lead to the infranuclear palsy, and the lower motor neurons, these are involved in case of the nuclear plus the infranuclear palsy. Here, the paralysis of the upper as well as the lower face on the same side is seen. The most common type of the intranuclear palsy is the Bell's palsy, where it can be idiopathic or it can be due to the herpes zoster infection. Lower motor neurons, these are involved. Facial muscles of the same side, these are paralyzed. And the patient comes with the features of facial asymmetry. Then there is a loss of wrinkles on the forehead. Widening of the palpebral fissure is seen and there is inability to close the eye. There is loss of nasolabial furrow and accumulation of the food occurs in the vestibule of the mouth because of the paralysis of the buccinator muscle. Then there is continuous dribbling of the saliva from the angle of the mouth. Treatment given to it is only the supportive therapy is given, and the patient can be completely recovered or partially recovered around 2 to 8 weeks of the course. Then these are the different lesions at the in case of the intranuclear palsy. If the lesion is proximal to that of the genicular ganglion, then there is loss of lacrimation, there is loss of stapedial reflex, then there is loss of taste from anterior two-third part of tongue, lack of salivation and paralysis of the muscles of the expression, facial expression. So all the muscles, they get involved if the lesion is at the level of the proximal to that of the genicular ganglion. If the lesion is proximal to nerve to stapedius, that will lead to the loss of stapedial reflex, loss of taste from anterior to third part of the tongue, lack of salivation and paralysis of the muscles of the expression. If the lesion occurs just proximal to that of the caudate tympani nerve, then there is loss of taste from anterior to third part of the tongue, and there is paralysis of the muscles of the facial expression. If the lesion occurs distal to that of the stylomastoid foramen, it will lead to the paralysis of the muscles of the facial expression. The crocodile tear syndrome. Now, when their lesion occurs at the proximal to that of the genicular ganglion and at the time of regeneration, if the salivary fibers, they joins with that of the greater petrosal nerve and enters into the pterygoparotid ganglion, it is manifested as a paroxysmal lacrimation during eating. So this syndrome is known as a crocodile tear syndrome. Just to summarize, we have seen the different functional components, the detailed course of the nerve, then the tracing of the fibers of the facial nerve, then branches and the distribution of the facial nerve, and the applied importance of the facial nerve. These are some references for the today's lecture. The images are taken from the textbook as well as the Google images. It can be asked as a long question for the university examination. Thank you.